now we're moving on to our first presentation. We're very fortunate we were able to negotiate with the Department of Education, Skills and Employment to have Raj Martin join us today, the Assistant Secretary of Governance, Quality and Access Branch in the Higher Education Division. Raj oversees and is responsible for the quality, equity, infrastructure and regional, rural and remote initiatives within the higher education. So I think all of us will enjoy hearing from Raj and what the commitment is from the government within regards to the higher education sector and disability. So Deb's going to share your slide and over to you, Raj.
Great. Thanks very much, Darlene. And before I start, I'd like to acknowledge the traditional owners of the lands on which we're all meeting today and pay my respect to elders past, present and emerging. So thanks very much for that introduction. I've got a fair bit of content to cover today, so I'll try and move through that fairly quickly and have some time at the end for questions. But also there's an email address that I'll show at the end. There's other things we haven't been able to cover or that I've run through too quickly if people need to follow up. So next slide, please. So in terms of what I'm hoping to cover, a little bit at the start, just around what I look after and some of the other things that are happening in terms of broader background and context. Talk a bit about the Disability Support Program and National Disability Coordination Officer Program. In terms of the two existing programs that are on the branch. And then spend a bit of time, which I know hopefully will be of interest to members in terms of things that are coming on the horizon that will have a bearing on things. So the Job Ready Graduates Package brings some changes around equity programs. There's also the review process around the Disability Standards for Education, as well as some really exciting stuff around a new panel that's been formed to develop a roadmap for equity over a five-year period, and some work that we're doing within the department to improve the evidence base around equity. Next slide, please. So very quickly, our department has gone through a number of changes. So earlier this year, one of the changes was that Skills and Employment returned to the department. That's been back and forth across different portfolios. What it does mean is that now within the one department you have right through from early childhood, schools, skills and higher education through employment, quite a broad range of policies and programs that affect people throughout their life course. So that provides a lot of opportunities, I guess, in terms of building those connections. And from my perspective, it's from schools into higher education and other pathways, and equally building better connections. And I know that's particularly an issue for people with disabilities for post-graduation transitions to work as well. Next slide, please. So the things that I look after in my branch, I've got a team that kind of works with the regulator, so TEQSA, the Tertiary Education Quality and Standards Agency, and also the Higher Education Standards Panel. That's relevant because of things like the Higher Education Standards Framework and how that places responsibilities on providers around the way in which they include different cohorts of students and so on. We've got a policy team focused specifically on equity, so that has a broad remit across the different underrepresented groups, including students with disabilities. I've got a program management team that administers a number of the equity programs, as well as a bunch of other ones around higher education infrastructure and so on. And that's where the DSP and NDCO programs sit, as well as HEP. And then I've got two teams that are focused on regional education issues. And that's been a particular focus of government, flowing on from the NAPTHON review that was finalised mid last year with the government response mid this year. Next slide, please. So this won't be news to anyone, and it does factor into some of the issues that no doubt or have certainly been raised with me in terms of the extent to which funding has kept pace with growth in students with disability, but also, I guess, provides a useful look around what the data is telling us, notwithstanding there's challenges around self-reporting and so on. But I guess from a positive perspective, seen quite strong growth over the last 10 or so years. So moving from about 4.3% in 2009 to 7.3% in 2019. So, yeah, as I said, that raises some issues around funding and the extent to which funding has kept pace with that. But depending on the different figures of prevalence in the community, for me, the question is, how do we then continue to close the gap to ensure there's parity between the broader population and the student population reporting disability? So just, I guess, a slide around trends and also scale. Next slide, please. So in terms of those two programs, as I mentioned, the Disability Support Program, close to 8 million each year. And that's really intended to be a contribution towards the costs of higher education providers undertaking inclusive activities for students. So it doesn't, and I don't think it's ever intended to be meeting the full cost, but as I said, we need to be mindful of the extent to which and some of the changes which I'll talk about to that program, how that's playing out in the sector. Next slide, please. So some of the changes, I've got a couple of slides on that. So expanding out so that providers can claim reimbursements around some of the staff training costs and some of the costs associated with modifying course content and so on. Trying to reduce administrative burden, so moving from a heavy sort of claims focus to distribution now based on a university's relative share of students with a disability. And only requiring claims for support and equipment over 10,000. Next slide, please. So yeah, some of the changes, and this was based on consultation that's now a little while ago, so I think it was in late 2016, but shifting from the old system, which as I said, heavy claims focus, large volume of lower cost claims, and high administrative burden to a newer system, primarily driven by enrolments. And our understanding and the data that we've seen suggests that that is simpler, more stable, and a transparent way of the relative distribution of those funds between different providers. Next slide, please. So that commenced, those changes commenced 1 January 2020, but because of, I guess, the delay between when some of that data comes through and so on, I guess that will be then reflected in terms of payments that we make next year. So just, I guess, acknowledging that while that's been in place for close to 11 months now, but then the payments associated with that then flow in the following calendar year. Next slide, please. Quick one, just I guess acknowledging the important role of ADSET. That is something that we certainly value and very pleased to be able to increase funding to ADSET to 150,000 from the previous 75,000. And also there was, from memory, 96,000 that we're able to make available to ADSET to support activities in the sector responding to COVID. So that's just a brief acknowledgement of ADSET. Next slide, please. I'm just conscious of time, so I'll move quickly. NDCOs, so again, people in this audience would know very well. So 15 host providers, 31 regions. Next slide, please. So for me, the critical thing is previous evaluations. This is a long-running program and the recommendation around shifting to a more strategic focus. So the past quite a long while now, there's been a conscious effort from the department's perspective around raising program activities to a more strategic level. Next slide, please. So that, I guess that that imperative remains. And so one of the things that we're interested in looking at more closely is how the structure of the current program then either supports or potentially any changes that might need to be made to give effect to that need to have that more strategic focus. So whether or not that the sort of 31 individual regions and the level at which they engage, the extent to which that meets that ability to support a shift to a more strategic focus. So nothing concrete in that. That is something that we remain interested in, and we'll certainly be consulting with the sector as we explore that further. Next slide, please. So a couple of changes, not specific to disability, but I guess in the broader equity context. So the Job Ready Grads package was announced 19 June, passed through Parliament not that long ago, but has some changes. So this slide talks about the Indigenous Regional Low SES Attainment Fund. So that will combine HEP, regional loading and enabling loading. Those existing programs will continue, and funding will continue to be distributed in line with that through to 2023. And during that period, we'll work with the sector to look at some of the, any refined funding or distribution arrangements post 2023, so commencing in 2024. Next slide, please. And then the other one is changes to the HEP program. So that's broadened out now to include Indigenous and regional and remote students in terms of their eligibility, and also the distribution, the formula drives distribution between different institutions. So that commences in 2021, but with a phased implementation and support through the transition fund to try and work to remove any possibility that institutions will receive lower funds in aggregate over time. One of the other changes is there's also a regional priorities pool alongside the national priorities pool. Next slide, please. I'm trying to go fairly quickly to make sure there's a bit of time for questions.
So, Darlene, we haven't been rushed off our feet with questions. So, but if anybody does have a question, put it into the chat pod. Thank you.
Okay, great. Thanks, Darlene. So Disability Standards for Education, very important document. They, I guess, run alongside and interrelate with the higher education standards. So they, every 5 years, they go through a review process. So that review's underway. Next slide, please. If we could flick to the next slide, please. So I was very lucky to be able to be part of those consultations, including with Attend and other key stakeholders in the sector. So that consultation period ran from sort of mid-July to the end of September, and the intent is that the final review report, which is being dealt with in another area of our department, there's a specific task force looking at that, will be provided to the Minister by the end of the year for consideration by all governments early next year. Next slide, please. So one of the interesting new developments is that there's a new equity in higher education panel that's been formed. It's a high level body, so includes a number of vice chancellors, as well as other senior people with experience in equity. And the primary task that they have is to develop a student equity in higher education roadmap. So that's very much the headline high-level document that we're looking to engage the sector broadly in terms of setting out a clear plan for how we have an increased focus on improving outcomes for underrepresented groups and over that five-year period. Next slide, please. So it will do all the things that roadmaps usually do, so setting a vision, prioritise plan, and raise profile. So yeah, in development, and the next slide talks to some of the consultation process, but that's really, that's a very high priority and high focus for my branch at the moment. Next slide, please. So one of the things that's been emphasised by that panel is the need to consult very broadly and in a co-design sort of fashion. So we're very keen to engage with you and this sector. And if we can go to the next slide, please. We're looking to do that through a variety of different ways over the coming period. So Initially, there'll be a discussion paper. We're working with the National Center for Student Equity in Higher Education to do a range of other things to get much better engagement and access to student cohorts and others that we ordinarily wouldn't through a sort of standard discussion paper process. So series of surveys, virtual roundtables, and as I said, working with the National Center to actually consciously try and get much broader and deeper engagement than we otherwise would. Next slide, please. Okay. Then the last
thing. Yep, Raj, we just got 1 minute to go, so thank you.
Yeah. The very last thing was in parallel with that focus on the roadmap, we're also doing a number of things to improve the evidence base around equity. So I'll run through it very quickly, but one of the things we're doing is a scoping study to inform the next post-schools destination survey. So that's making sure that we have the right coverage and the right questions to make sure we have robust evidence in that longitudinal study to inform equity outcomes. And the other one, I won't run through the slide, is we're doing some work to establish a evaluation framework really for equity practice, primarily structured around the HEP program. So both of those in conjunction are really trying to build the evidence base, make sure we have a really robust set of information to work from and to then target both future activity and to the extent it's available, any future investment into the equity space. So thanks very much. Great. I think I've zoomed past the last couple of slides and right at quarter past.
So thank you, Raj. Sorry we haven't got time for questions. Are you okay if we've only had one question in the chat box, but if we get any more, are we right to put that to your office and see if we can get some answers for those people?
Yeah, sure. And so just the email address that's on screen now. Darlene, whether or not you want to coordinate or if people want to individually just write in, then that's
brilliant.
Very welcome.
Excellent. So thank you very much for your time.
Great.
And have a great day. Thank you. Fantastic.